Well, what a pleasure to be here and to have Ambassador Ross and my colleague Gabby Blum on this panel. I'm presently teaching with Professors James Sabinius and Nick Burns a course entitled Great Negotiators, Diplomacy, and Intractable Conflicts. We claim, and I think it's true, it's the first time there's been a course offered jointly by three professors from the business school, the Kennedy School, and the law school. And as I suggested earlier to Ambassador Ross, two of his books, one on statecraft and one of them on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, are centrally featured. Now, I guess because I've been especially interested in what I'll call intractable conflicts, and I'll put it in quotes. And I think it might be fair to say that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is perhaps the poster child in that regard, and that at least three American, the most recent three American presidents, President Clinton, President George W. Bush, and President Obama, with respect to the final status issues, attempted very serious initiatives, mediation efforts, with which you've been deeply involved. And none of them succeeded. Indeed, they all failed. And I guess if you could just put it all in context for us in the following sense, identifying what you see as the primary barriers and what makes this particular conflict so apparently intractable?
Well, thank you for allowing me to start with a simple question. You know, I would say that any conflict that is characterized by a lot of mythology and a lot of history and too little geography is going to be difficult to resolve. There have been times when I would have said that I was more optimistic about being able to resolve it because I felt the combination of circumstances in terms of leadership and the environment in which the psychology of all sides was lending itself towards trying to resolve the conflict gave me a feeling that there was a real possibility. I would say in the from 93 to 95, even though the negotiations were that I was heavily involved in were difficult, you had an Israeli leader in Rabin, you had an American president in Clinton, you had Yasser Arafat, who was a Palestinian icon and therefore had authority, and you had an expectation on the part of the publics that I felt at that time we really had a potential to resolve the conflict. There was a point later when obviously we went to Camp David in the year 2000 where again I felt you had an Israeli prime minister who wanted to resolve the conflict, you still had President Clinton, and you still had Yasser Arafat. What we found at that point was that on the Israeli public side there was a very high expectation that something was going to be done. I think on the Palestinian side, there was already the signs of increasing frustration at the public level, in part over the fact that the conflict had not been resolved, even though you had a five-year clock that had been established, and it was supposed to, by May 1999, we were supposed to have resolved it, and there was a lot of corruption on the Palestinian side at the grassroots level, so that the mood among Palestinians began to turn more sour. Maybe more sour than we fully appreciated at the time. And Arafat, I think, at a certain point, either Arafat was never capable of taking the leap because it meant too much personal redefinition. He had to go from being a revolutionary to being a statesman, and that was just too big a leap to take. So that even though I thought that there was a potential to resolve the conflict in the year 2000, we found out that, in fact, even though people think we came very close and we did the Clinton parameters, We were probably not that close because at that time you had a Palestinian leader who had the wherewithal, the capability to resolve the conflict, but not the intent to resolve the conflict. The longer time drags on, you then deal with something else, which is a psychological transformation on all sides, but particularly on the part of the two parties. Today, there is, I would say, fundamental disbelief on the part of both sides that you can resolve this or that either side has the intention to resolve it, meaning they may see themselves as being willing to resolve it, but they're convinced that the other side will not. And when disbelief takes over, it creates a context where it makes it enormously difficult then to take on history and mythology. Any intractable conflict, almost by definition, is a conflict that is characterized by a long, deep history where the narratives on each side are deeply embedded. When you have those moments where you've suddenly shaken things up, 93 to 95 was a period where things were shaken up, meaning that we had moved from an existential conflict, two national movements competing for the same space, who had rejected each other's existence, now prepared to say, let's make this a political conflict and let's see if we can settle it. The longer time has gone on, the perception of the other, rather than being transformed by the negotiations, has become more deeply rooted, so that Israelis look at Palestinians today and are absolutely convinced under no circumstances will they accept a two-state outcome, meaning a Palestinian state and Israel is the homeland of the Jewish people, the state of the Jewish people. Israelis view Palestinians as favoring a Palestinian state and a binational state. And Palestinians look at Israelis and say they have no intention of ever giving up occupation. And if they really believe in two states, how come they build in what should be our state? And the longer this goes on, the deeper the disbelief, the harder it is then to have leaders who say, I can do this without producing the kind of backlash that becomes prohibiting. And so where we are today is at a very low ebb, where the disbelief is the most prominent feature in the conflict, meaning each side disbelieves the other is serious about ever being prepared to have a two-state outcome, where the leaders completely distrust each other. And I think we're at I don't think we've had any point since I've been working on this where the leaders are so convinced that the other is not serious and will never be serious. And where the US is also perceived as being largely ineffective. So if you have a triangular element here where you need, in an intractable conflict, you may need the help of a third party, not because a third party can make peace for the two sides. At the end of the day, they have to make peace, they have to invest in it, they have to believe in it, they have to defend it. But sometimes they need a third party who can help them manage the process to get to a point and can manage their explanations, because there are no agreements unless each side has an explanation. So we have a kind of the trifecta in the worst, not in the way Dick Vitale would say it, but a trifecta in the worst, whether you're basketball fans, in the worst possible way, that the publics disbelieve each other, the leaders are completely distrustful of the other, and neither of the two parties looks at the US as being capable of managing, fairly or not, but that's the way they perceive it, as being capable of being able to manage an outcome. So we have all the elements that make an intractable conflict remaining intractable, and we don't have any of the elements that give us the means to begin to disaggregate these fundamental differences and begin to find the points of commonality and build an outcome.
I guess I'd like to ask one follow-up, and that is, I've long thought that I think there are a number of barriers, and I think your description of the current situation and its backdrop is extremely perceptive. But if I had to, if someone asked me, what do you think is the primary barrier, and what has been the primary barrier, I've thought and I've written about, it's the internal conflicts on each side. Among the Palestinians, the most conspicuous, of course, is between Fatah and Hamas. And the average Israeli thinks, well, even if Abu Mazen is someone who is opposed to violence and might be prepared to accept a two-state solution. Why should I think Abu Mazen has any influence with respect to Hamas and Gaza? And on the Israeli side, the internal conflict isn't quite as profound, although at lunch today, Ambassador Ross indicated that Prime Minister Rabin in 1992 indicated that he was pleased that he really had the IDF, the Israeli army, behind him, because he feared the possibility of an internal civil war among Jews in Israel if he was going to do what he hoped to do in terms of creating a two-state solution. And we do know that it is no joke that Netanyahu would have great trouble holding on to his own party, Likud, if he simply broadly stopped the expansion of settlements. So on both sides, there are these terrible internal conflicts. Mm-hmm. The dilemma is, what can be done to ameliorate those, particularly when it appears each side has an unerring capacity, the leaders do, of often doing things to provoke and make worse the internal conflict on the other side, rather than thinking about what might I do to make it easier for the guy on the other side to solve his behind-the-table problem. It's often quite the reverse.
You know, look, it's a very important question, and I guess I would make a number of comments about it. First, and it gets to the very last point you made, the way you overcome these kind of internal differences is by demonstrating, by finding ways to take steps that proves the arguments of those who want to settle it and discredits those who are resisting it. The more on the Palestinian side they can see that a nonviolent negotiating pathway actually produces results that can be seen and felt, the more you strengthen the authority of a leader who's prepared to make hard decisions. The more the Palestinians are seen by Israelis as genuinely being prepared to end this conflict, the more it strengthens the hand of an Israeli leader who is prepared to do these hard things. I mean, just to cite an interesting example on the Israeli side. At the time of the assassination, which, by the way, of Rabin, which proved, in a sense, his own understanding of what he was facing, there was a genuine outpouring of grief among Palestinians, which shocked the Israeli public. And it created a very different impression until you started having acts of terror 3 months later about who was there. Later on, I would say there was, you know, when there had been long periods where there had been no terror, there was a strong sense among Israelis that one of the reasons that Netanyahu lost to Barak in 1999 was there was a perception within Israel that there actually was a Palestinian partner, but the Israeli government wasn't capable of acting on it. And so suddenly you saw a level of support for what was perceived to be those who can do something about this. So one way to get at this is, and that's why I come back to here, if you have sources of disbelief and you want to at the same time deal with that issue on the one hand and also tackle the issue of the internal dissonance and the internal division which you're raising, which is such an inhibitor, you have to create what would be a parallel set of steps that would begin to show, no, those who argue that nothing can be done, and that's the strength of the people who reject, is actually not real. So if the Israelis suddenly made their settlement policy consistent with their two-state policy, announcing we're only going to build in what is our state, we're not going to build in what is their state, we know we still have to negotiate a border, but until we have a border that will define where we can build and not build, we'll only build in what we think is our state, not their state. Two, we will give incentives to those who live beyond the barrier, which is when you say you're going to build only in your state, not the other, actually to come back. And we'll even do housing for them. Well, that would send a message, geez, the Israelis are actually pretty serious about trying to change, or pretty serious about two states. And if you open up Area C, which is 60% of the West Bank, to economic activity, all right, that would send signals. I'm not saying it suddenly is revolutionary, but it begins to create a set of arguments that, all right, something's different now. And on the flip side, if Palestinians would say, you know, we respect the fact that there's two national movements and there need to be two states for two peoples, when most Israelis think that they're not only interested in a binational state, well, that would have an effect. And if Palestinians would acknowledge that, you know, if we have an agreement, those settlers who are here can stay, but under our law. It can't be the way all the Israelis have to leave, all the Jews have to leave. Well, suddenly it begins to change. Well, what are these guys about? So one way to deal with what you're raising is, how do you begin to show or strengthen or empower those who believe in trying to settle this? And what can you do to undercut the arguments of those who are resisting this? I mean, one thing I have pushed for some time as well, I've had a lot of ideas over the years that others have been able to restrain their enthusiasm about. One of the things I pushed pretty hard for in this administration was to focus on some of these parallel steps, and I actually outlined at one point 16. But one of them was to have each side begin to acknowledge when the other did something positive. Mm. As opposed, they're great at focusing on, you know, whatever is driving them crazy, boy, they'll emphasize everything that's negative. But how about, you know, on the Israeli side, the Palestinian security forces, the Israelis, most of the IDF and the Shin Bet will acknowledge they carry out their responsibilities professionally. Look, they won't say they're the IDF, but they'll say they carry out their responsibilities professionally. Not to say, look, there are policemen, but we respect them because they carry out their responsibilities professionally. And just say that as a sign of respect. Or, you know, any Palestinian who really needs treatment at Hadassah will get it. And Palestinians, by the way, you know, a lot of them know this. Well, how about acknowledging it publicly? Instead of demonizing, if you watch Palestinian TV for 5 minutes, you don't have to watch it longer than that, you will hear that the Israelis are responsible for every evil there is on a constant, repetitive basis. How about saying, you know what? A sign of Israeli humanity is that they treat Palestinians at Hadassah Hospital. We appreciate that. I mean, these are just two examples. The point is, when something that is positive, how about acknowledging it? So you begin to build some momentum behind what's positive and not what is this kind of constant effort to see who can score more points about who's more negative.
Gabby. I'd love your thoughts about your sense of the current political scene within Israel and the extent to which the issues, for example, with respect to the Palestinians are being given much emphasis in this current campaign.
Great. So I think you initially you framed your question to Ambassador Ross in the frame of intractable conflicts. And, you know, it's always the $64,000 question when you think about intractable conflicts is, are they really intractable because there is no ZOPA in your language, in the zone of possible agreement, or are there just obstacles, whether they're communication obstacles or logistical obstacles or anything that has to do with the bargaining process itself that you could overcome and then meet your ZOPA. And the reason why this particular conflict, any particular conflict, is so tragic is that the parameters of a deal are known to everyone, more to anyone in the room. It's to Ambassador Ross, probably to few in the world as Ambassador Ross. There are the same as the Clinton parameters from Camp David in 2000, few amendments or changes, tweaks here and there. And it turns out that when you pull the two societies, you find a majority. When you say, this is the final agreement, this is what it's going to look like on the ground, do you support it, yes or no? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. But there is a real problem A, in getting there, and B, in ensuring that that deal is actually sustainable. And I think this is what's holding, which kind of puts back to the question, is there a real ZOPA? So what's the political climate like? There are elections in 10 days. The Palestinian issue is non-existent. It's almost not, the elections are not about that. They're about Netanyahu. They're about his leadership style, his wife, his ethics, even the last week with a big speech in Congress. It wasn't so much about Iran or the Iranian issue per se that people were following. They were following Netanyahu's brinkmanship. Can he get away with it? How far can he get away with it? What's going to happen? How is it going to affect? It was much more ad hominem, I would say, than it was about the issues themselves. And to the extent there are other substantive issues on the ballot, there are social and economic problems. Protective Edge has done, the last war in Gaza has done little, I think, to change fundamental views. I think people moved a little bit to the right after or during and after the war, which is to be expected. And then it basically served to reinforce your prior. So whatever it is you thought politically was the right thing to do before the war, you were only reinforced in that position after the war. Now, why is it difficult to anticipate a change after the elections? The agreement is going to be, any agreement, the agreement we're talking about, is actually extremely difficult to execute. Extremely difficult to execute. So what are we talking about? We're talking about evacuating 120,000, more or less, Ambassador will correct me about the numbers, 120,000 Israelis from their homes in the West Bank. Israel in 2005, in the summer of 2005, evacuated around 8,000 people from Gaza. I was there in the Israeli National Security Council. It was tremendously hard to do. It was tremendously hard to do. The country was on the verge, I don't want to say civil war, but there was a serious turmoil. And these were only 8,000 people from a closed off area, an area that you could cordon off security wise. You could, you know, just make sure that nobody exits or enters into Gaza. These were not the hardcore settlers in terms of, we'll call it, political, religious convictions. Most of them were sort of what we call economic settlers, people who wanted to farm land in Gaza, etc. This is not the story in the West Bank. You're talking about 120,000 of the hardest core of settlers who are all over the West Bank, very hard to cordon off, very hard to avoid sort of sympathizer from coming and joining, and it's going to get bloody. That is the assumption. It's going to get really, really, really difficult and dangerous to do. The military has also changed. The character of the military, even from 2005, the national religious role in the military taking far more prominent roles, leadership up and down the ranks, which also makes evacuation by the military more difficult. The coalition, the party's landscape, we're continuing the trend that we've seen for the last couple of decades, smaller and smaller parties, no longer the two sort of dominant major parties having lots of seats in parliament. Out of 120 Knesset seats, the two major parties today are sort of in the range of 22 to 25. That's what they're aiming at. And with lots of other sort of medium and smaller sized parties, which inherently create unstable coalitions. Invariably lead to unstable coalitions. No government succeed in running its four-year term, and it's becoming much more difficult to carry out long-term strategic and certainly something so costly like a peace plan. The payoff is unclear. The payoff is unclear in two senses. So Ambassador de Ross mentioned suspicion, deep suspicion on both sides. From the Israeli view, it's not just that can you trust the Palestinians to deliver on their side, and is it going to be the Abu Mazen Palestinians or the Hamas Palestinians? But the region is in such turmoil that you're not sure who's going to be in the West Bank tomorrow or Gaza. And if it's not Palestinians, Could it be Daesh, ISIS? And there is a sigh of relief that you can hear throughout Israel for not having made the deal with Assad in 2000, when the deal with Syria came up very close, and it came up to the point that President Clinton was snubbed by Assad, the father, Hafez al-Assad, and Israel would have returned the Golan Heights only to have ISIS sitting in their backyard or their northern yard. And that is a real concern to Israelis about the stability overall in the region. Can we trust that we make a deal, we evacuate all the people, we sort of demilitarize the area, we take risks, Jordan Valley, yes or no, only to find a very menacing force on the other side? And the other element is that the stalemate isn't really hurting. The stalemate isn't really hurting. Most Israelis can live very comfortably with the current situation. And yes, you go through these iterated rounds of conflicts. They're getting more and more frequent and more difficult. Certainly, the fate of those who live in the south of Israel is very different from those who live in Tel Aviv and in its surrounding. But it still is the case that, by and large, goes back to the question of payoffs, the stalemate isn't hurting. And you have to think about how to change that. You have to think about how you change the structure of the payoff, how you make the deal more attractive, and how you make the stalemate on both sides more costly.
Thoughts, reactions?
Look, much of what Gabby said, I think I agree with. I mean, I think there's a couple of points I would make, because there are some implications that also flow from that analysis. One is, one way to make it more attractive and more appealing on the Israeli side, and frankly also more doable on the Palestinian side, is if you have an Arab umbrella. Here you have a convergence of interest between the Israelis and the Sunni Arab states. Over lunch I was describing, you know, think about the following. The Secretary of State, John Kerry, is in Saudi Arabia yesterday, and the Saudi foreign minister says, our main concern is Iran. Okay, our main concern is Iran. Gee, I think there was a speech this week, you know, in Washington that also seemed to put the main concern on Iran. I was describing a couple of articles that have appeared recently in one of the leading regional newspapers, Shekel Ausset, that where one of the writers was from 3 weeks ago wrote an article saying, why are we cheering? And this was an article quoting from social media from throughout the region in response to the Israelis hitting this convoy just above the Golan Heights. And killing an Al-Quds general, an Al-Quds force general. And in a sense, he was talking about how, and other Hezbollah operatives, and Abdul Rahman al-Rashid was saying, look, we all sort of rejoice over that. And in effect, he was saying, Israel's not our enemy. Doesn't mean Israel's our friend, but Israel's not our enemy. But the Iranians are our enemy. ISIS is our enemy. The Muslim Brotherhood is our enemy. But the Israelis are not our enemy. So from the Israeli standpoint, the public may look at the Palestinians and say, what comes after them? We don't know how sustainable this is. But if we have basically all these Arab states who are prepared to make peace with us, we face this common enemy, and collectively we can deal with these threats. So that can appeal more to the Israelis. The irony is, I look at the Palestinians now as being both disinclined to make peace because it's too costly. There is nothing in the Palestinian political culture today that justifies the idea of any compromise with Israel. Quite the opposite. It's illegitimate to compromise with Israel. The sense of grievance and anger is so deep-seated, and the division among Palestinians makes anything that looks like you're prepared to accommodate the Israelis unacceptable. So the idea that you can now make the kind of hard concessions to close a deal with Israel is politically simply not in the cards, unless there's some cover. And you're not the one absorbing the responsibility for the concessions the Arab states are. Now, the question becomes, Are they willing to do that? Is the Palestinian issue important enough to them to be willing to do it? Right now, you'd have to say no. There isn't a sign that they're so concerned about that. It ranks way low on their list of priorities. But it's not to say you couldn't test the possibility. If the Israelis, for example, if the next Israeli government were to take some initiatives, you know, make your two-state policy, make your settlement policy consistent with your two-state policy, talk about 67 and mutual agreed swaps as a baseline for negotiations, and accept the Arab Peace Initiative as a broad umbrella for discussions, not the, you know, the principles have to be discussed. You know, you could see whether there's a level of interest on the Arab side or not. So I do think the region, what Gabi said about the region, is very important. If you're an Israeli and you're looking at the region, everywhere you look, it looks bad. And you want to see who are your natural partners for contending with this, and is there an Arab orbit here where, given your convergence of interests, you can do something collectively? The Arabs would say, you know, Israel may not be our enemy right now, but they can't be our friend until they're prepared to deal with the Palestinian issue. And this is where there is some merit here. The only other comment I would make, Gabi was talking about the evacuation of the settlers. At Camp David in the year 2000, it was the Palestinian side who said the Israeli settlers don't have to leave, but they can stay, but they have to stay under our law. It was the Israeli side at that time that wasn't prepared to accept that. In the most recent negotiations, it was the Palestinians said, no, they all have to go. And it was the Israeli side that was saying, how about they stay under your law? Now, this is something else. Most intractable conflicts, the other thing, the sides are rarely in sync. But the point here is that to contend with the numbers of those who are living there, if there's acceptance of the principle they don't have to leave, but they have to live under the Palestinian law, you're going to have a lot who are going to choose to leave voluntarily under those circumstances. But you may be able to manage this. I agree with Gabi, the idea that you're going to forcibly remove 100 to 120,000, that's really hard to imagine. And from my own standpoint, you know, if 22% of Israel is Israeli Arab, I don't know why Israeli Jews can't live under, and they would not be Israeli Jews, they'd still be Jews, but they would live under the sovereignty and the law of a Palestinian state. I mean, that is, it seems to me, at least theoretically, one way to contend with what otherwise would be a problem that is almost impossible to overcome if you're requiring evacuation.
Gabi, what are your thoughts about the Arab Peace Initiative?
I think it was, in some ways, the most important change or important piece in the puzzle in the last decade, in the following sense. Ever since Madrid, 1991, Madrid had two tracks. It had a multilateral track and a bilateral track. From 93 onwards, from the Declaration of Principles onwards, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict has been consistently addressed as such. A bilateral conflict that has two parties, one mediator, sometimes a group through the quartet or other interested players, but very much a bilateral issue. Now, not only was it only a bilateral issue, but it was a bilateral issue that was very conveniently exploited by other leaders in the region to justify why they weren't doing certain things or why they were doing certain things. And it became a very convenient excuse throughout the Arab world. Well, you know, why don't you promote human rights or women's status? Or why is there no economic development? Why are there no more political reforms? The most convenient excuse for everything was the Israel-Palestine conflict. You first need to resolve that, then we'll do stuff for us. And it was... And it reinforced the problem of the unclear payoffs and the obstacles of getting into a deal. One way you can alter the structure is by introducing more actors to the game, turning it from a bilateral issue to a regional issue, which in many ways it is. And in many ways, I think the mistakes have been to continue to look only at these two partners, Israel and Palestine, and not think about the possible role of Jordan, and not think about the possible role of Egypt, not think about the possible role of Saudi Arabia in different ways. Now, there are all kinds of ways you can parse this out. You can think about economic cooperation. You can think about environmental cooperation, industrial cooperation. You could even, as some suggested in Israel, or there have been some suggested, even thinking about land swaps or broader land swaps that are not just between Israel and Palestine, but include some transfer of land, for instance, with Egypt to make Gaza larger. Without, you know, addressing the merits of each of these particular plans, expanding the lens, I think, really expands your option. Now, the one, obviously, Israel, you know, a former boss of mine used to say, there's a big difference between saying no and saying yes, but. The right answer to the Arab Peace Initiative should not have been no, it should have been yes, but. And here is the big but. What the Arab Peace Initiative basically says is, Israel, you and Palestine resolve your issues. Once you reach an agreement, here is what will be able to offer. And when you put it that way, it's not attractive enough. So if you say to Israelis, you'll be able to fly to Riyadh. Okay, so today I can't fly to Riyadh, tomorrow I will fly to Riyadh. That wasn't enough. That's not enough. And again, it's not clear why you would go through all this trouble and again, all these costs of an agreement only to be able to fly to Riyadh at the end of the day. Where the game really changes is where you make the Arab countries a real partner throughout the process, where they have a stake in both winning and losing, where they have a role to play more than just telling Abu Mazen, no, no, don't compromise, or don't go that far, or it'd be better if you don't do that. But making them, of course, you also introduce spoilers in that way, but making them parties to the process itself throughout, not just saying once there is an agreement, you guys enter into the picture. And I think, you know, going back to what I said earlier, if you want to talk about different payoffs and you want to talk about a different changing the calculus of the stalemate, a regional outlook is really the way to go.
I guess a last question, perhaps before we open it up. With the benefit of hindsight, what would you have done differently with respect to 2000 and the Camp David initiative? And what would you have recommended to President Obama and Secretary of State with respect to the efforts more recently?
Well, I would say first with the, what I wish I had done differently in 2000 and even earlier, I would divide it into two parts. The first part is, I wish that we had adopted a stronger position. I put myself, when I say we, I mean me. And I had been successful in convincing the president that on the settlement issue, we should have been stronger. And on the Palestinian non-performance on security, we should have been stronger, not because those are morally equivalent issues, they are not, but because the settlements made the Palestinians feel powerless. And by making them feel powerless, they had much less of a stake in the process, and it made it look as if they were achieving much less. And this gets back to the idea, how do you strengthen modern forces, not how do you weaken them? And on the performance, non-performance on security, this was so fundamental that in the case of the settlements, I would have had us say first to Rabin, even though Rabin was prepared clearly to do a lot, that if you want our involvement in this process, you can do what you want to do, but if you want our involvement, we simply can't play the role unless we see that this is really going to be very much limited. In a way that it doesn't have to be a complete stop, but it has to be limited in a way that doesn't so undercut the Palestinian side. And with Arafat, I would have said, we're out of this process. You know, we will simply stop, and we will not do a thing for the Palestinians until we see you perform on security, full stop. He wanted a relationship with us. He wanted us in the process. We should have made our involvement conditional on his performance. Now, before 2000, I wish that I had come up with the idea that I came up with after the summit. I wish that rather than going to the summit and focusing on trying to resolve everything, and there were good reasons at the time, and I can go through, I've written about it, I can say it here and explain it, but I wish I had thought of the following, that the president would have gone to the two leaders and said, you know, I am prepared to try to resolve this whole conflict, but I'm not prepared to resolve this conflict until I know that each of you are actually capable and willing to resolve the whole conflict. For that reason, I need you each to prepare your public for compromise on the final status issues, because that'll tell me you're ready. In the case of Barack at the time, he was doing it, but in what I can only describe as a bizarre way. Everything that was being said formally and directly was very limited, and the leaks out of the government were revealing all the things they were prepared to do, which of course undercut him politically without creating any benefit. But the same thing should, but Arafat, we should have said to him, we need you to say that neither side is going to get 100% of what they want. You need to say it publicly and you need to repeat it. And if each side had said, well, we can't do this, then our position should have been, well, then we're not going to work for a permanent status agreement because it's clear you're not capable of doing this. Now, you ask, I had learned that lesson by the time of this administration, so I did make this recommendation. And I actually, when things were about to break down for, in the process, last spring, almost a year ago, not quite a year ago, I actually suggested in private, and then I actually published an article on it. I suggested that the secretary, since he was the one carrying this, should go to Netanyahu and should go to Abbas and say, look, you both say you want to solve this. By the way, the reason Kerry made this effort was because each side had said to him, both the Prime Minister of Israel and the President of the Palestinian Authority had said to him, we don't want more limited agreements. Prime Minister of Israel, because his attitude was, any limited agreement I'm going to pay a price for, I might as well pay the price only once. And Abu Mazen said it's too late to go for limited agreements. So I suggested, why don't you go to each of them and say, I'm ready to go for the whole deal, but I don't know that you are prepared to do what it takes. So to Prime Minister Netanyahu, I need to know that you're prepared to say that you're not going to build beyond the blocks, because that'll tell me you're prepared to take on the constituency that's most going to limit you doing this. And I need you, President Abbas, I need you to say that at the end of the day, there's going to be two states for two peoples, reflecting the fact that there are two national movements, a Jewish national movement, a Palestinian national movement, and we're going to have two states for two peoples. Now, if each of you can say that, then I know you're prepared to do what's hard for you and to take on those forces politically that are trying to limit you. And if you can't do it, no hard feelings. I understand it. But we're going to work for something. We're going to improve the realities on the ground. We're going to work to try to change the circumstances so what you can't do today, we can do over time. I think had I been smart enough to realize that before we went to Camp David, it would have been better for us, because we would have found that Arafat wasn't prepared to do anything. And then we would have redefined how we approached it. And had this been done, I think, last year by Secretary Kerry, then, in a sense, he would have been able to explain, even publicly, you know, we have redefined what we're working towards. I understand the difficulties for each side. And we're going to work within the context and within the constraints that they're able to operate. You know, that way you have an explanation for what you're doing. If you're pushing for something you can't achieve, then what you're going to end up with is an American failure. And right now, we don't need more manifestations of American failure. We need manifestations of American effectiveness, which then creates its own kind of momentum. And it would have also, in a sense, been more realistic for the two sides. So you could have begun to focus on what was practical. And we need to focus on what's practical right now, because a lot of what's happening on the ground is promising to deteriorate further. And, you know, Gabi was talking about the stalemate is, you know, they can live with a stalemate. Well, we may be headed towards something where they can't live with a stalemate.
Well, let's take some questions. What I'd like to do, if I could, is prefer students with questions first. I think we have some microphones around. If you could make sure that we get questions and not statements, so I want to hear a question mark at the end.
Thank you very much. I'll make a very short question then, and I'll even gesticulate the question mark at the end. The impression that I've gotten, first and foremost, I want to thank Dr. Blum and Ambassador Ross, but the impression I got from Ambassador Ross is the United States sort of just sits back and is a very kind tea time server, inviting the people over. Yet, do you really think that the United States, and this goes for both Dr. Blum and Ambassador Ross, that the United States is an impartial tea time server? Question mark. Are we impartial? Question mark.
Well, there's really, even though it was a short question with a question mark, you're actually posing two questions, not one. One question that you're posing is the U.S. passive in this approach and just sort of dealing nicely and gently with the two sides? And the other question is, are we impartial in terms of the way we deal with the two sides? So it's two different issues. On the first issue, I would say we're not passive. But it also depends upon the negotiation we talk about. This last negotiation, Kerry carried the whole burden because it wasn't a negotiation like in the past. In the past, the negotiations were direct. Oftentimes they were two-way, many times they were three-ways, but they were direct. In this go-round, they weren't direct. There was a short period of time where they were direct, and then Kerry basically adopted a position of he negotiated with each of the leaders in parallel. And that was a very active American role, to be sure. And unfortunately, it wasn't successful. So I would say in different periods, we've played different kinds of roles. The Clinton parameters was not a case of being passive. We put a proposal on the table. I was the principal drafter of it that was designed to meet the needs of both sides. So that was a very active effort at mediation. Now, on the question of partiality, I'll tell you, I gave a speech in Gaza in 2005, a few months before the Israelis withdrew. And I was out of the government at that point. I wasn't in the Bush administration, Bush 43, I was in Bush 41. I wasn't in Bush 43. So I gave this speech to a couple hundred people. Unbeknownst to me, when I got there, I had been invited by Ziad Abu Amr, who's a member of Fatah. But he invited me, and when I got there, the first person I saw was Mahmoud Zahar, one of the founders of Hamas. And before I could say anything, he said, "We thought the opposition ought to hear you." Well, my basic message didn't change much because I was talking to them about how they could take advantage of the fact that Israel was going to withdraw from Gaza. This was a moment for Palestinians to shape their destiny and then not say that it somehow had been denied by others. They could turn Gaza into a going concern. The world would say, if it's good enough for Gaza, why not the West Bank? And probably most Israelis would say the same. But if you turn Gaza into a platform for attacks, then who would say, gee, let's take that fail model and apply it to the West Bank as well? Needless to say, we know what happened. But the reason I mentioned the story in response to your question is because most of the people there said, the U.S. isn't an honest broker. I started by saying, well, you know what? First of all, when you ask a question, you don't want an honest broker. I mean, the nature of your question is you want the U.S. to be on your side. So you don't want an honest broker, in fact, when you ask the question. But that doesn't really reflect what your real needs are. What your needs are is you need an effective broker. And an effective broker is someone who may have a close relationship with the other side but understands there's no deal unless we can address the needs of both sides. And I said, this was at a time in 2005 when, you know, the Bush administration for the first several years did nothing on this issue. They walked away because their attitude was, that's what Clinton did. We don't do that. It wasn't until the last 2 years of the Bush administration that they got serious about working on peace. And I asked them the question at the time. So you complain about the U.S. being too close to the Israelis, and they can't be a broker. Well, are you happy with the last 4 years? You've had an American administration that really wasn't a broker at all. Has that been in your interest? And notwithstanding the fact that most of them had been asking hard questions, no one was prepared to say at that time they really didn't want the U.S. involved. And they wanted the U.S. involved in the end because they still understand the only country that could influence the Israelis was the U.S. I said to them, we will always have a special relationship with the United States, I mean, with Israel. We do have a special relationship with the United States. We will always have a special relationship with Israel. But I said that doesn't preclude having a very good relationship with the Palestinians. And in the end, it doesn't preclude us being able to be an effective broker. You know, typically the word honest broker is used whenever you're not happy with the mediator. But whenever the U.S. mediates, if you look historically, and this is in the Statecraft book, by the way, when I talk about mediation, we typically have a relationship with one side that is much stronger than the relationship with the other side. You know, Holbrooke, when Holbrooke was the mediator at Dayton, the Serbs knew that he was much closer to the Muslims, but that didn't prevent him from being an honest broker. George Mitchell went in, and the Protestants were very suspicious of him because of his relationship with the Catholics. Both were effective brokers, and the notion of an honest broker is typically something that is used when you don't like the way the mediator is operating. But the measure is whether the mediator can be effective. They don't have to have equal relationships. What they have to do is they have to be prepared to understand what each side needs and to find ways to address it.
So I think it's exactly right, if I can add a couple of words. So the country that first mediates this dispute isn't the United States, it's Norway. So you go back to the beginning of the Oslo process, 1992, 1993, before the Declaration of Principles becomes, before it becomes known that there is an Israeli-Palestinian dialogue. At that time, in Israel, there is a law prohibiting meetings with the PLO. There are people who are in jail for having met with PLO representatives. And the country that actually provides auspices for a secret, covert dialogue between Israelis and the PLO is Norway. And they all meet in a lakeside mansion. It's very picturesque. They're cooped up in that mansion. They play with the kids of the host. And it's intended to provide a very quiet, safe, secret environment for talking. For that, you need impartiality. And maybe we'll call it neutrality, in the sense that you provide the auspices, you allow for a dialogue, whatever happens, happens, you serve everybody with the same kind of respect and dignity, et cetera, et cetera. That's not what you want from the Americans. That's not what you want at this point. At this point, you want somebody who can twist arms if necessary, who can provide sticks and carrots if necessary. The United States paid a lot of money and still paying for the Israeli-Egyptian peace agreement. It pays both sides, okay? That you couldn't ask of Norway to do. And you have to be careful in your assumptions about what you want the mediator to be able to do, what role you're expecting from the mediator. And the more you want the mediator to play an active role in what's happening, by the way, throughout the negotiation and afterwards maintaining the stability of the agreement, you want guarantees, you want assurances. In some ways, you want the United States to become a party to the agreement to raise the stakes for both sides for violating it. And for all these purposes, impartiality is not what you're looking for. It's way overrated, and we'll call it that way.
I would only add one thing. The other thing that the political leaders, the domestic political leaders responsible for the negotiation often want is the excuse to make an extraordinarily painful compromise for which they're going to be criticized. You can't say Norway made me do it. You can say the American president really twisted my arm at the end. And so I think for all those reasons, as a practical matter, if you want, you know, it's not as if the United States, I assure you, there are American presidents that wish some other national party could play this role effectively. But in today's world, I don't think it's conceivable that it will happen without deep and substantial American involvement in the process. That's my own guess. Another question, please.
In June 2002, President Bush called on the Palestinian people to pick new leadership not compromised by terror. Is it time for President Obama to call on the Palestinian people to pick new leadership not compromised by corruption?
It's an excellent question. Because I do think the corruption issue is contributing a great deal to the deep disaffection of the Palestinians right now. There is tremendous, I think there's tremendous frustration among Palestinians, and a lot of it is directed towards Israel, to be sure, but a major part of this, I suspect, is because of the level of corruption. I do wish that we were paying more attention to this. I do wish we were making it more of an issue. I do think it has been a mistake for us not to invest more in the ground-up effort, not as an alternative to the top-down, but the top-down effort could never succeed on its own. It needs the ground-up as well. And that, by the way, would make it clear that something is at least happening. I think it's, you know, we, Salam Fayyad was literally forced out as prime minister. And he was a guy who introduced transparency in their budgeting process. He was building institutions. And he produced a big backlash from within Fatah because it meant that a lot of those who otherwise would have been benefiting were losing out. And they put a lot of pressure to have him removed, and eventually it succeeded. And I know that at times Secretary Kerry was making an effort to sort of bolster him, but we have not done enough on the ground up effort, which is something that was absolutely within our power to affect and to contribute more to. And the institution building on the Palestinian side would have been farther advanced. And by the way, had we put more emphasis on that, and particularly the rule of law, then you would have begun to constrain what is the corrosive effects of the corruption. So, you know, the problem with big presidential declarations, if they're not followed up by anything, is they look empty. I am a bigger believer in doing more and talking less. And if we're going to talk, make sure that whatever we say, we actually do. Again, as an example, good statecraft, you don't have a big gap between your objectives and your means. Well, that also means when you frame issues, you don't have a big gap between what you say and what you do.
Scanning, I think I see another probable student question, and then we'll open it up to non-students as well. Right there in the black sweatshirt.
Hi, my name is Nancy. I'm a sophomore at the college. I guess it's funny because the title of the event is Israel's Elections, and we haven't spoken much about that. So I'm going to bring that up. We mentioned briefly how actually the Palestinian issue is not at all on the table, at least the main table, during the elections. And I'm wondering if you guys can talk more about why that is and whether that means that Israelis feel that they don't have a stake in the conflict, or whether that means that they feel despair or hopelessness about the conflict. That's all.
Gabby, why don't you start with that one?
I think it's the latter. It's the latter in the sense that they feel that nothing can really be done. So, you know, they look ahead and they say, Either they don't believe that there is a political will on the Palestinian side, or they don't think there is a capacity to do something, by the way, either on the Palestinian side or on the Israeli side. There's also power in the numbers. You see how many people within the Israeli population are against an agreement and against doing something. Again, I still think there's a majority, even among Jews, if you exclude the Arabs from the polls, just Israeli Jews, there's still a majority. But there is, excuse me, a sense that a deal is very, very hard to reach. There isn't the political will or capacity to reach one or execute one. And it's not clear. And for all those reasons, it's not big on the agenda. It's not big on the agenda while other issues are more pressing. The economic conditions, social conditions. Ambassador Ross mentioned Hadassah, why the Palestinians don't talk about the fact that so many of them come to the Hadassah hospital for treatment. So if you looked at the Israeli press the last week, it's all about the crisis in healthcare, how the Israeli hospitals are overwhelmed, how everything is stretched too thin, that the system is collapsing, that there isn't enough doctors, aren't enough nurses, no staff, no beds, that it's becoming a third world country. Some hospital manager even said something close to, this is systematic murder, or this is a calculated murder of the population. So very, very strong words. So the Israeli prime minister, for him, it's very, very difficult for him to stand out and said, look at all these Palestinians we're treating. We're so humanitarian. We're wonderful. He'd be asked the next day, we don't have enough beds for us. You're treating the Palestinians, with all due respect to your humanitarian sensibilities. This would be, politically just not feasible. And then there is, again, the events of Protective Edge. And Protective Edge, again, as I said, really, more than anything, just reinforced your priors. So either you believe the Palestinians cannot be trusted, there is no real partner, even if you talk to Abbas, what's going to be with Gaza, how do you ensure that there is a different reality in the West Bank and that the PLO is not replaced by Hamas tomorrow morning. And there's also a sense of internally, looking around at the political party and the political landscape. People, I think even, obviously there's the people who don't want any political progress, but even for those who want political progress, there isn't a whole lot of hope, I would say, that there is going to be material, substantial change in the near future. By the way, even Herzog, who is sort of the leader of the biggest party on the left, what he's talking about is a five-year framework, a framework of 5 years for negotiations. That doesn't sound like very urgent, right? So what I'm going to do tomorrow morning is run immediately to a political. 5 years, 5 years. No Israeli government is going to survive three, let alone five. We can all talk about five-year framework.
Let me add a couple points. When my reference to Hadassah wasn't for the Israeli prime minister to say it, but to have the Palestinians to acknowledge it, but that's okay.
That's also going to kill him.
So, I think the main point that Gabi's making, the only thing I would add to it, because I agree with it, it gets back to my theme on disbelief. If it's completely disbelieved, one of the reasons that you're not going to, if you're a candidate, and even if you support doing something more quickly, you don't want to look naive. The whole public thinks this is impossible. One poll I saw showed 69% of the Israeli public believes in a two-state outcome, and 91% believe it'll never happen. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to look naive, or to use the Israeli term, you don't want to look like a friar. You don't want to look like a sucker, because nobody wants to look like a sucker in Israel. And you don't look like you're chasing after something that's an illusion, and you don't even get the reality in which you're living. So there is no, the mainstream in Israel don't see this as that's something that's actually going to happen. Why invest in it, particularly when you're surrounded by all these enemies? And suddenly you look at all these, you have all these economic, social economic issues, the high cost of housing. So there's a, you have a kind of, Israel, like a lot of the Western countries, has this strain within the middle class. And the focus on the middle class has been a major part of many within the election. You have the Prime Minister of Israel, because he's been Prime Minister for a long time, is trying to focus the issue on the broader security. And so everybody's talking about every issue but the peace issue, because it's not seen as having any real salience within the public. And it's worse that the problem is, not only does it not have salience, it may make you look naive.
Maybe one more word. The gentleman who asked that question before left, but he asked about corruption. He asked about corruption on the Palestinian side. The Israeli headlines over the last 2 or 3 years are all about, or very much about, corruption in government, all the way from former Prime Minister Olmert to the entire command. That's not corruption, but sexual harassment and sexual scandals in the police. And a sense that the entire faith in governance structures is fading. That there is a real kind of crisis of faith about, do we really have a first world flourishing democracy, or is this more of a banana republic? And the anxiety about that is very real. Now, it's coupled with the question, and when Netanyahu talks about an existential threat, people think an existential threat is the face of the nation, the character of the nation going forward. So a majority of first graders today is non-Zionist. They come from two communities, the Arab community and the ultra-Orthodox community, both of which are non-Zionist. So a majority of first graders today are not Zionists. And the question is, what is going to be the face of the nation when you have increasing number of populations who are non-Zionist, a crisis in effective governance, ethics in government, the bodies are entrusted with law and order, can't be trusted. And there is a sense that there is real capacity questions way before you get to the question, can I evacuate 120,000 people? But can I have a functioning government that provides adequate housing, adequate health care, kind of basic services? This is now my existential threat, not the question of a long-term agreement with the Palestinian. And the big dividing question between left and right is that the left believes that the two questions are intertwined. They are too dependent on each other, that you cannot have effective government, that you cannot have law and order, that you cannot have a Zionist majority if you don't deal with the Israel-Palestine conflict. And the right believes that these are two completely separate questions, and the things that you need to deal with internally, you need to deal with internally. And Palestinians are a different matter, it can wait. And there's no rush, and we hope facts on the ground would resolve themselves.
Yes, sir. Is microphone right up here, please?
Thank you. I believe there are more Palestinians living outside of the West Bank than there are in the West Bank. I don't mean just those that are in Lebanon, but for example, in Jordan. In fact, Palestinians are either a majority in Jordan themselves or close to it. So isn't the nature of the West Bank going to change a great deal if following some kind of peace agreement?
Isn't the nature of the West Bank,
once you take these other Palestinians into account, many of them wanting to come to the West Bank or other factors, particularly the fact that they may be a majority even in Jordan. Isn't the nature of it following some peace agreement independence, nature of the West Bank going to change very much?
Well, I think that its population will grow for sure. How much is hard to say. I mean, one of the things when we were trying to negotiate with the Clinton parameters, the essence of the Clinton parameters was that the Palestinians would have a right of return to their state. They wouldn't have a right of return to Israel. So the question would be, what kind of absorbability would they have? You could provide a lot of help from the outside. you know, there have been polls that have been taken that among Palestinians that show, very relatively small numbers would want to return if they had the choice to Israel, which in a sense the only choice they would have is if the Israelis were prepared to admit them. And it wasn't clear how many would actually return to their state, that many might prefer to take compensation. So it's not, you know, it's a, you can presume an answer here, but it's hard to know what the answer would be. I think the more interesting question from my standpoint is, what's the relationship between the Palestinian state and Jordan? And I do believe that in a lot of ways, Jordan, from a security standpoint, could be an anchor to any agreement. Mm-hmm. That what would give the Israelis a much higher level of confidence would be that a lot of the security issues and the level of cooperation between Jordan and the Israeli military wouldn't change from what it is now, and you could address many of some of the questions that Israelis might have if Jordan were to play a more prominent role in the security in the aftermath of an agreement, including along the Jordan River.
Let me make two observations, then I'm going to ask you each to make a final comment. In dispute resolution, what mediators are often faced with, and I've had a fair amount of experience as a mediator in commercial and industrial cases, and I've had some experience internationally, is mediators typically want parties to a conflict to look to the future, to look to their underlying interests, and to imagine a future where their interests are better served than their alternatives if they stay with the status quo. Often parties, and I think your characterization of the current Palestinian mood mm-hmm. captures this, human beings, apart from wanting to pursue their interests, are also instinctually justice pursuing. And people have their own views of justice. But in this conflict, justice, by the way, when you're involved in a conflict, often involves looking backwards and having someone else pay for the wrongs that were done to you. And in this conflict, both sides have long lists of the wrongs done to them over the last years and decades. And to the extent they focus on that, it makes things much more intractable. And I just offer that as an observation. The second thing, and this is something I really learned from Ambassador Ross, because I've thought about this conflict seriously for at least 10 or 12 years in my own professional work. Part of me always wondered, and I was a little skeptical, Israel has the IDF, one of the great armies of the world. Why aren't they prepared to take greater risks for peace? And what I learned from you in your writing is the notion that for the Israelis ever to accept a deal, it's not going to come because they're feeling more anxious in terms of their own security and that they are willing to compromise because the alternative looks so bad. And I think that what I've come to understand is psychologically for Israelis, many Israelis, I don't want to overgeneralize, for understandable reasons historically having to do with the Jewish people, and their own history with all these wars. In today's world, they have enormous amounts of free-floating anxiety about security. I mean, someone this morning at a very interesting session said, his daughter said she had a nightmare that someone was coming through a tunnel up into their house to kill his 8-year-old daughter. Is that very probable, given that they live in Tel Aviv? No, but I give it only as an example. And so a dilemma with this conflict is, how do you get people to focus on the future? How do you get them psychologically to give up a pursuit of justice which is going to make a deal impossible? And how do you get them to honor their own need for security but not set security demands at a level where it's going to be impossible.
Okay. Want me to go? Look, I'll make two points, one of which we really haven't raised, but I feel a need to raise it, and it's connected to the first point in some respects. I think it's very important for the next Israeli government to take a series of initiatives, you know, make your settlement policy consistent with your two-state policy, so you're only building in what you think is your state, not in the Palestinian state. Be prepared to do some things on the ground to make it easier for the Palestinian private sector in particular, but also to make access easier for Palestinians. Accept 67 and mutually agreed swaps, and then be prepared to treat the Air Peace Initiative as an umbrella for talks. When I say this, it's not because I expect that the Palestinians are going to respond. I expect the Palestinians actually will not respond, because I think the Palestinians at this point have shifted their paradigm. They're not interested in negotiations. They're not interested in being in a position where they have to make any concessions. They've moved towards internationalization of the conflict because it requires nothing of them. And if the Israelis are going to take initiatives, then it's very important that they do it because it'll stop or blunt the delegitimization movement against Israel. But then it's very important, I think, for the United States and others to focus on ensuring that the Palestinians respond, and especially the Europeans. For the Palestinians, you don't do the Palestinians a favor when you let them off the hook and never require anything of them. When we're focused only on what the Israelis must do and never what the Palestinians must do, particularly when the Palestinians find it costly to even think about compromise, so they won't do that, then you're ensuring they will never have a state. A strategy that is focused on being a victim guarantees one thing: you'll always be a victim. So for those who actually are serious about wanting to see a Palestinian state, it's important that we get the international community to require something of the Palestinians, particularly if the Israelis move. If the Israelis don't move, you're not going to move the international community right now. So the Israelis have to take a step, and I hope in the aftermath of the next government's formation, that'll be the case. And this is at least the second point. I don't know how many of you saw on the front page of the New York Times today this what happened at UCLA. It is, in a lot of ways, the fact that you asked what happened was you had someone who was being considered for a student council position at UCLA was asked the question about being Jewish and whether she could be, she wouldn't be biased. She could be fair. I mean, that such a question could be asked is unthinkable, but not surprising, because there has been a tendency now, as part of the delegitimization movement of Israel, to then delegitimize anybody who would support Israel. And you can be a supporter of Israel without supporting all of Israel's policies, but that wasn't what she was being asked. She was being asked a question simply because she was Jewish, and the presumption was if she was Jewish, she must, therefore, support a state that, by definition, is not legitimate. And that we could get to this point should be disturbing for all of us. That it is the kind of thing that would happen on a college campus shouldn't be surprising, given the momentum that's built up behind delegitimization and, in effect, what I consider to be the new form of anti-Semitism. And I hope that on this campus and other campuses, that kind of a mindset will be challenged, not just in a rhetorical sense, but it will be delegitimized because it has no place anywhere, least of all on a college campus.
So related to your question about justice and the rhetoric of justice, I think one of the worst things that happened in the Israeli-Palestinian relationship is there was never a lot of it, but the evaporation of sympathy and empathy. That for anybody that thinks that time is neutral, time is not neutral. Time doesn't stand still, things don't stay the same. And one of the things that have happened in this bilateral relationship is that there has been less and less sympathy and empathy, more and more animosity, suspicion between the two populations. I remember talking to friends of mine during the last war in Gaza. People were left-wing or, you know, center-left with a super kind of right-wing rhetoric because they were under sirens. Because they were under sirens and under attack. And, you know, friends of mine said to me, if my kids need to sleep in a shelter, their kids should sleep in a shelter. And that was the sentiment. Now, of course, the same logic works the other way around, right? The moment your kids are under attack, you yourself under attack, your ability to be sympathetic or empathetic to the other community is zero. And one of the things we need to think about is how to sort of take out justice as much as possible from the equation. I don't know how much it is possible to build in sympathy, but at least build in self-interest, pragmatic self-interest that would articulate the process and the solution, not in terms of this is to be nice and because it's just, but because it really serves your own self-interest. And maybe one final word as a citizen of Israel, as somebody who deeply cares about this issue, I can't speak on behalf of Israel, but I think I can speak on behalf of many Israelis who are very, very grateful to Ambassador Ross for the work you've been doing for decades in the region. A lot of it very ungrateful work and not always pleasant, and so much of your time and effort and soul went and is going into this, and I at least am very grateful.
I think that's a wonderful note to close on, and I just want to thank my colleague, Gabby Blum, and Ambassador Ross for coming to Harvard and educating us.
Thank you.
And I hope you return often.